This is FX Medicine. I'm Andrew Whitfield Cook. Joining us on the line again today is Rebecca Guild, who studied naturopathy and Western herbal medicine at the Academy of Natural Therapies, graduating in 2003. Rebecca has worked in pharmacy, her own clinic, in varying capacities for one of Australia's largest practitioner supplement companies, and more recently as the editor and curator of FX Medicine. Bec is now involved in complementary medicine education, sales and marketing, digital and social media, and is a passionate advocate of naturopathic medicine in the integrative health model. She has a keen interest in the regulatory landscape of naturopathic medicine in Australia and likes to inspire current and future students to strive for meaningful careers in the profession. Welcome back to FX Medicine. Bec, how are you?
I'm well, thanks. Thanks for having me.
Now, today we're going to be talking about one of your favourite things and one of my least favourite things, and that's social media. There are big questions often asked. Where do we go first? Where do we need to fit in?
The big question there is, and I think because obviously we're talking about this from the standpoint of our industry, our profession, so practitioners would mostly want to know what social media places should I be in for the benefit of my business, right? That's probably the number one question. If someone says, I know a little bit about social media, that would be the number one question. And so my answer to that is, well, that depends. You want to fish where your fish are swimming, and you need to really understand who your audience are and what are you hoping to get out of using social media. Is it that you want to get more clients, or is it that you're interested in being part of media? Are you going to sell courses or ebooks, or, you know, what is it that you're going to do? So that's going to really define it first. But I think if we're going to generalize, I think there's two major places. One is Facebook. Everybody knows Facebook, or Bookface, as I know you sometimes call it. That's kind of become the playground, the social media playground. That's where all the kids are these days. And it doesn't matter what age group you're in, everybody's got a Facebook. It's like email years ago. Not everyone had email to start with. And now it'd be really rare to find someone who doesn't have an email. And I think the same is kind of true of Facebook. So everybody in general tends to have a Facebook. Then the next most rapidly growing social media platform by far is Instagram. So what's the difference between the two? Facebook is a mixture of visual and words, and you can post links, and you can create photo albums, you can create groups and pages. You do have a lot more functionality through Facebook. Instagram is a little bit more limited, but it is growing in its various features. And the reason I think Instagram is growing is because it doesn't tend to attract the negativity and the trolls that we see in social media as much as perhaps Facebook does. It's a bit more pretty and engaging and what have you. So I think that's possibly a major draw card for its popularity and why it's growing so fast. And, you know, if you're doing it for business purposes, you'd probably want to be on Facebook if your market is the market that's sort of maybe 25 and over. And if you're into the market that's, you know, 40 or 50 or 60 and over, if that's your target market for clients and patients, then 100% Facebook would be the main and possibly the only social media platform, unless you've got some really early adopting grannies and grandpas going on out there.
Right.
Whereas with Instagram, I think you can capture an audience that is that 25 and under. There's still a lot of people that are probably, say, 40 and 50 and under. But for the most part, I think that it's sort of come out after Facebook did, and with the more older generation, they're a little bit more comfortable with that format. And then if you said to them, go and get an Instagram, they'd just be like, well, that's too hard. I've already got Facebook. Why do I need another one? Whereas the younger generations are just, they're just quite happy to take these things on, the early adopters and the Gen Y and all that sort of stuff. So those are the two main ones that I think most people would be using for business purposes, depending on one other factor, and that is if you're more a business-to-business business yourself, if you're business to business rather than business to person, then I think you'd be more likely also to find some source of opportunity in LinkedIn, because that's more, you know, to categorize them. LinkedIn is like a business networking group of old days, whereas Facebook is like the playground or the park that everybody kind of frequents in, or the local coffee shop or whatever. And Instagram is like the brag book, the flip book where you're showing people your pictures. And, you know, Twitter is more sort of sound bites of information. So Twitter's the other one, but I think it's an interesting one, Twitter. I don't know if there's too many people that spend a lot of time on it anymore. But the great thing with Twitter is it's person to person. Businesses, like even us at FX Medicine, we have a Twitter, but I think people would be more interested in talking to Andrew Whitfield Cook than they would be in talking to necessarily FX Medicine, or they might talk to FX Medicine thinking they're speaking only to you, for example.
I don't know about that, but anyway.
Yeah, no, I do think so, because, you know, being on the podcast, you become the natural face of the brand, of who that business is. Or to put some other examples there, let's say, I know it's not really functioning the same anymore, but I Quit Sugar would have had a different following and readership than Sarah Wilson herself. Some people would have preferred to speak directly to her as the creator of I Quit Sugar than they would have to talk to the brand per se. And or another example might be Cindy O'Meara and her clinic and business changing habits, and her documentary series What's With Wheat. That all have their own social media platforms, but people would go to the different ones for different reasons, right. So having an understanding that people go to different places for different reasons can therefore answer the question of, well, which social media platform do I need to be in?
Are there any other platforms that might be relevant?
Look, probably the next most common one would be something like Snapchat, but unless you were in a business that was really seeking like a much younger market, or I think that it might be it's more of a difficult one to be involved in. And like Twitter, I think it's that one moment in time, and then the time has passed you by. Like, the content doesn't tend to have as much of a life cycle. So yeah, it's probably, and there's probably a lot of businesses who do it well, but I haven't dived into Snapchat myself, because I can't see the value in that real, you know, quick bite of information.
A big issue with regards to social media is just how much time it takes. Indeed, I think somebody was saying that people are nowadays looking at their phone or some other medium of connection with the internet within 15 minutes of waking up. One of these issues is time. How can practitioners make their social media as time effective as possible?
It's the million-dollar question, because the more you do, the more you have to do. That's probably the number one. I think, and that is, you know, where things like Twitter and Snapchat can take up a huge amount of time, because it's very small bites of information, but they still have to be physically created. Whereas something like Facebook is a little bit more forgiving, because we as practitioners are probably reading an extraordinary amount of various things on a daily basis anyway, even if we weren't doing that connected to our social media. You know, we might be reading studies or research, or we might be reading the particular expert or whatever it might be. We might be watching a documentary. And from those pieces of information, we can kind of pluck out little things to mention into our social media. That's totally possible, and you can do that through Facebook, because you can apply URLs and links for people to go and read more on the topic or whatever. And with Instagram, you don't have to necessarily be putting as much content always out into it as frequently as you would with, say, a Twitter or a Snapchat, because some people are using that news feed a little bit more slowly. And the other thing is, if people come to your profile, then those pictures are always going to be there unless you elect to delete them, so that they are there continually a source of information for clients at a glance. But to answer how can you make it time effective, I think the number one thing is to have a set up some boundaries around how long you spend on it. And we're all guilty of it. I know it's the first thing I do in the morning and the last thing I do at night is check my notifications just to make sure I haven't missed anything. So, you know, setting up boundaries for that if it's connected to your business, definitely. The other thing is that there are so many social media scheduling apps that you can get now. And so where these really become great is so the one I have the most experience with is Edgar. And I think Edgar's a great one if you have as a business a website or a blog and you create a blog post and then it goes out and you might share it in your newsletter or you might share it when you initially come out with it and then it kind of just stays there on your website. And unless people are searching for it or what have you, it's sort of just there. So the great thing about Edgar is it's sort of a tool that helps you to cycle back through that content and just kind of plop it into your social media on a regular basis. So we use that a lot with FX Medicine because, you know, we have so much content covering a plethora of things and then we have new content coming out on the month. So we use the Edgar to just schedule out some of the content that comes out so that the older things just get like, oh, hey, remember this infographic or hey, remember this piece of research or remember that post I did about that. And then all I do is I go in and once a month I might change some of the wording or I might move some of the items around. And there's other ones that you can use like Hootsuite and eClincher. I've got to admit I don't have a lot of experience with them, but they do schedule out posts in a really similar fashion. Another thing that you could use as well is a tool that's called If This Then That. So ifttt.com. And that is like, so if you just put a post into, say, Instagram, then you can go into If This Then That. So if I post on Instagram, then post that also to Facebook. Or if I go to Twitter and post something, also post it here. And so you can go in and set up these recipes that if I do A, please do B. And then that just naturally takes care of it. So sometimes when I've gone away, I'll just say, oh, can somebody just manage, say, Instagram? And then I set up If This Then That, and then it'll just go out. And, you know, there are some nuances for the various social media where it doesn't always work the greatest.
Right.
But at least there's some content going out there if you're away or if you want to just do it for a week or whatever it might be. So that's a cool little tool and it's free. The scheduling tools they're probably number one. Some of them do cost. So some of them are $50 or $60 a month. So you'd have to be able to go, is there value in that and is that bringing it in? The other thing you could do is, I mean, just having a Facebook page, for example, for your business is kind of like having a landing page for your website. And so you might have a few bits of content just on a Facebook page, but you might spend, instead of spending your $60 a month on your scheduling tool to make sure people are coming to your website or your blog, you might not have a rich website or blog and you might just be using that website for appointments, let's say. Then I would spend that $60 a month not on a scheduling tool. I would spend that $60 a month in Facebook advertising and use targeted advertising campaigns to attract customers to my website who then would book in. And you would do that with, you know, you could do that with any number of methods, a picture, a website, a testimonial, a what have you. There are some ways to make it work for you without having to be chained to it, I think.
I've heard some people talk about virtual assistants. What's that about?
Yeah, so a virtual assistant or a VA is someone who you pay to be your personal assistant, somebody to do a function that you need from an administrative perspective usually. And so it's really common that people will outsource a virtual assistant to do that kind of thing for them. And there's a number of them that you can use here or abroad to do it. Probably what I would say though is do your research on that. You probably, especially in if you're a health professional, you probably really want to make sure that if you're getting somebody to do that, that you're giving them a very clear brief on who you are, what your tone of voice is, what are the things that are acceptable to your brand, what kind of messages you want sent. So you do have to do a bit of work. It's not as simple as getting somebody to just come in and take over the reins and just post with that kind of hit and hope mentality that you just throw any kind of content. So I'll give an example of that. I know someone who used a virtual assistant and that person was in the fitness industry and I think that because they were busy, they didn't want to necessarily look after their Instagram or pay as much attention to their Instagram, because they were focusing most of their own personal energy on, say, Facebook. And so they got a virtual assistant to sort of do the Instagram posts. And some of the posts are about fitness services, such as, say, Zumba, that personal trainer didn't actually offer.
Right.
And because they had the virtual assistant, it was sort of like out of sight, out of mind, right? So they weren't checking it either. And I remember bringing it to their attention, like, oh, hey, did you know that, you know, they're making a post about this and you actually don't offer that service? It's sort of not on brand for you. And so they didn't know. But it just made me realize that sometimes something that's supposed to be a solution can actually turn out to be a little bit more work than it brings benefit.
Yeah, I'd have like real issues letting somebody who A is not me and B is not a professional in charge of that sort of message or any messaging that might taint your name.
Mm. Well, I mean, as a health professional, it's probably the risk is probably greater, but there are a lot of people who use virtual assistants. It's not just for social media. They might use them for any number of things, for answering phone calls and taking appointments as like a satellite office person as well.
Yep.
So
we're seeing that with medical centers now, and you know, the home call medical doctors, right?
Yeah. Like they're just sort of taking a leaf out of some of our largest telecommunications suppliers and outsourcing that. Sometimes they're outsourcing it offshore.
What about testimonials? Have you got to be particularly aware and cautious of testimonials?
Technically, myself as a naturopath, no. Because we aren't currently registered. But if you are, say, an APRA, so with the Australian Health Professional Registration Agency, they do have some guidelines that they set out about the use of testimonials, and you would have to take them down, which is difficult. So obviously Facebook is a global, platform, and every country is going to have different rules. But a lot of business pages were naturally set up with the ability to do a review or a testimonial on it. And so under APRA guidelines, some of those testimonials actually are not allowed. You can't do them. They're almost construed to be a form of advertising that maybe lacks evidence, I suppose, for want of a better word. But yes, that it is something that you should definitely look into. In fact, there's a number of ways that I've seen people online kind of step probably unwittingly on regulation issues. Practitioners in particular, if we keep it to health professionals, if they're going to be popping content in there, that they need to make sure that they are aware of, say, copyright and image permissions. So if they take a picture, or it's really common to use an app for Instagram that reposts a picture, and usually the repost will give you the option to pop a credit for where it came from, so the original page, but you can elect to not have that. And if you repost it and you don't credit it, you know, you could get yourself into run into some copyright issues. Like, these are things to be aware of. Some of the other things are, I think a lot of health professionals probably don't realize that they need to make sure that they're doing the right thing when it comes to the therapeutic goods advertising code. So if they're talking about a product, and it might be that they've had a really great result with a product or a product that they really love, and they post a picture of it or maybe a video, and that's kind of construed as a therapeutic claim, or it could be, then they could, and the brand, depending on if there was a connection, could be, you know, running into a bit of a regulatory hurdle on that side of things. So it is certainly something to be aware of, like not making therapeutic claims, not saying that you can cure things, the amount of pages that pop up saying we've got the cure for this and the cure for that.
Yes, there was indeed a case just recently. This is being recorded in August 2018, and I think it was the 1st of August or something, there was a chiropractor just struck off because of claims that he was making on his website regarding curing cancer.
The other thing that practitioners probably need to check as well is association codes of conduct. And in particular, you know, now because with Facebook, for example, you can be connected to groups of your professional peers or other professions that are similar or in ancillary areas of industry. And you've got to make sure that you're communicating with those peers just like you would face-to-face. You've still got to be respectful. You've still got to be, you know, cautious. And I think it takes a different, like writing takes a different level of terminology. I think we've all seen the mem around about the value of an apostrophe, the difference between your, Y-O-U-R, and you are. It really is important to make sure that your grammar and punctuation are great, especially if you're in a health industry, whereas you've got someone's going to entrust their health to you, and you can't put a simple full stop or use the right kind of terminology, or you spell something wrong, it kind of makes you look a little bit silly. Mm. Too many people aren't putting enough value into how they're communicating on social media, and how that affects the reputation of yourself or your brand.
So we've mentioned that a chiropractor was recently struck off for wild claims. What other ethical issues do we have to be aware of?
I think a lot of people would probably remember the case, which has become a landmark case that he went on to win with Professor Tim Noakes, and that involves social media, about the giving out of advice over social media. And so I think practitioners, if we're talking about health practitioners, everyone needs to be mindful that anything that is said or popped up into their social media feed can be construed as advice if it's coming from them or from their practice or their brand. And the way we answer things, people will often, and this happens to us at FX Medicine, people will often send through requests for information about, you know, serious conditions and various things. And I think we have to have very strong boundaries around that and answer it in such a way that takes care to show them that you have care for that situation, but that from an ethical and a professional standpoint, it may be something that they need to discuss with you in a consultation process or, you know, with their GP or their psychologist, psychiatrist, whatever it might be. And the other side of that as well is anything that goes into social media, and Facebook is a very good example of this with Messenger, it's usually connected to audio and whatever you're typing. So that's why, you know, you might be having a conversation with your friend at a coffee shop about shoes, and then you open up your Facebook and the next ad that you see is shoes.
Yeah.
So we do have to be mindful about maybe some of the privacy implications. But, you know, the thing is, a lot of our laws predate social media when it comes to, you know, the Therapeutic Goods Association Administration, for example. I remember something happening quite a few years ago and it being pointed out, well, hang on, the Therapeutic Goods Act was created in like 1989. It predates social media. There was no clause for a number of things, for the way perhaps items were being advertised or sold or claims were being made. So it's taking a long time for, you know, from a legislative perspective, for that to catch up as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And I think a lot of people probably don't, you know, I know until it was pointed out to me, I was like, oh, yeah.
We've mentioned a lot about what we want to do and how we want to place ourselves, what we want to promote, what we want to project. But how do we find out what our patients, our customers want?
One strategy would be to survey the clients that you already have, like what would they like to see you putting out information-wise on to social media, so that you're not putting all your energy into doing something that your own patients that you have already aren't going to find of value. Mm-hmm. Or taking a look at pages that have a really big following that are similar to your industry. And using Facebook again as an example, you can do this. If you have a business page on Facebook, you can go into the analytics and you can jump on there and pick out a few pages that are similar to yours in nature and see like what their number of following is, what their engagement is, and how it's comparing to you. And I suppose another thing I would point out is just because someone up a Facebook page or an Instagram page has 100,000 or 1 million followers doesn't mean that that's how many people are seeing their messages or how much engagement they're having. So engagement is the measure of how many people maybe click on to like or comment on the post usually. And it's probably, most times, it's probably 10 to 20% or less to what your following is. But you could have someone who has 500 followers and every one of those followers hangs on the every word of whomever the page they're following. Mm. You might have 5 million followers that, you know, they might catch a post from that page, you know, once every 6 months. So there's some power commanded in the numbers, but it's not the be all and end all. Just if you've got 200 followers on your Facebook page, but they interact with you and they engage with you and they chat to you and they like your stuff and they share your stuff, that's more than enough to go on. But in terms of how do we determine what to send there, yeah, I think you've got to ask them. And there's some cool ways to do it as well. You can start polls on Facebook. You can do in the Instagram stories, which is it's like creating your own personal daily documentary Instagram stories, but you can pop in there, you know, questions and polls, and the people can write responses and answers, and then the analytics will take it out for you so you can find things out that way. And then, yeah, just monitoring it. Just if you're really just starting, you need to monitor it and see what it is that people are engaging with and what are they sharing. And that gives you a clue as to where you should spend your time and your energy. And probably one thing I should have mentioned at the beginning, if you haven't started a Facebook page, I do think that that's probably the most logical place to start with Facebook. But something a lot of people aren't aware of, most of us, by the time we get to an age where we would go out in business, we would have 100, if not 200 or more friends. I mean, I know someone in our family went to create their Facebook page for their business from scratch. And I said, did you realize you could have created a Facebook page with your existing friends? You can turn your Facebook profile into a Facebook page and all of those friends automatically become likes to your page, so you don't have to build your audience from scratch. They built their page from scratch, but they could have brought their 1,500 or 1,700 friends that they'd accumulated throughout high school and college across to their page and they didn't realize it. So that's probably something a lot of people don't realize. And then, well, yeah, once you've got that audience, that's when you can start to, you know, what's working? What am I putting out there that people are interested in? How can I survey people? If you already got, you know, an email campaign that you put out regularly, you could pop a survey into that. You can create surveys through various, like there's Survey Monkey. So you could create a survey and then throw the link up into your social media field just to see what people are interested in. Ask your family and your friends what kind of things they would expect to see on a page that is a business like yours. You know, what other people are doing in the industry that seems to be working, and then ask your peers as well. I think there's a lot of people that do that also. I think the thing that stresses people out is like, where do I find the information, or where can I find things to post? You know, that's a conversation for another day, but there's lots of resources, I suppose, that people can use as well.
Over the decades that social media has been in existence, have things changed greatly as to the way that professional entities are marketing themselves? Like, I see a lot of, for instance, lawyers now on TV. You never saw that 10 years ago.
Yeah, I think, everything now is digital. And the great thing is, you know, when I went out into practice, when I graduated in, you know, the early 2000s, I didn't have a lot of options for marketing. I had to spend money for someone to create perhaps a advertising DL flyer for like a letterbox drop, or I might have been able to contact local schools and advertise in their PNC, or maybe I would have been able to stick my business card up on those pin boards where people's business cards go. But it was all very time intensive and I had to spend money a lot of the time to advertise or market myself, so I always had to rationalize that. Whereas, you know, fast forward now 10-15 years on, and there's a lot of options to market that are freely available, and social media is one of them. But there are ways, and the creators of social media have been probably not as quick as they could have been to jump on how to commercialize the fact that suddenly, where it became something that was just about connecting individuals, suddenly it became something that businesses were like, oh, this is a way for me to connect with my potential customers and consumers. So it has changed and it will continue to change. I think, you know, the things that you could do 6 months ago on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn, you name it, are different to right now, and they'll be different again 6 months from now as they also take their feedback and their analytics and they see what's working and what's profitable and what's doable and what have you. And, you know, a year ago or 2 years ago, I could have done a week's worth of Facebook advertising for about $7, whereas now if I wanted to generate the same kind of campaign, it's probably going to cost me $20 or $30 or maybe even $150. So, you know, that they're also capitalizing on that as well. And I'm certainly no expert in the marketing side of it, but you could do, I reckon you could just about do a whole course or a whole degree just on Facebook ads alone. It's so, you can be so targeted with Facebook ads. You can go, okay, I'm going to create a campaign and I want that campaign to go to anybody who sees content from these particular competitors who makes a keyword mention of naturopath, nutrition, gut, whatever it might be. You might pluck out keywords. Maybe it's a woman, or maybe your target market is pregnant women. So you might go, if they're liking the a baby center page or this page or that page, or they're in these types of groups or forums or what have you, like you can really drill down. That's why I think it's really important for you to sit down and go, you know, who is my ideal client? Or who are my ideal two or three types of clients, and then kind of construct what they look like and what their interests would be and how they might participate in social media. And then that can help you determine how you spend your marketing dollars if you're going to spend it, which Facebook marketing is just like the old drop the flyer in my mailbox.
Yeah.
It's no different. Like, you know, we used to check our mailbox every day. Well, now we check our Facebook every day and we forget to check our mailbox. We probably do it once a week and they come out soggy. So we check Facebook every day and the side panels, you know, they're very targeted. They're the things we're talking about. They're about the things we've liked or we're interested in. If you scroll through and you click on a Facebook ad and you happen to stop and watch the video or whatever, I can guarantee you if that person has set up their Facebook ads properly, they'll approach that ad will come back and recycle back to you in a retargeting campaign. I mean, it's nowadays there's been no greater time where you can isolate into exactly the people that you want to speak to maximize the bang for buck. And people will watch it. You'll go, okay, I spent $50 on this. I've got an example of someone I was talking to the other day. They spent like $50 doing an advertisement through Instagram, which through talking to her existing client base was how most people had found her, was through Instagram. And she spent $50. And from that $50, she got, I think it was over 100 inquiries, of which she probably converted over half. At a cost of, or at a benefit to her of $40 per client acquisition. So that $50 was really well spent.
Absolutely.
You know, to get you know, 40 or so times of $40 in revenue. So, and these are the things that you can do now, whereas I might have spent $120 on flyers when I had my clinic and I might have got 5 phone calls to the clinic and converted 2 or 3 of them. So I would, and there was my $125. And what happened to the rest of them? They probably got put into someone's kitchen and used for their grocery list. It's one of those things that everyone says that social media takes so much more time. Well, it does, but what has it replaced? What there are things that you're doing on there now that are not only free or that you could do that are free, that don't have to necessarily cost you money, but they will cost you time.
And they're better for the environment.
Yeah, well, absolutely. I'm very anti-paper these days. So if you can do digital advertising, I think it is great. I mean, they're all points to consider, you know, how do you maximize your marketing dollar? And then once you've done that marketing, if you are getting inquiries or what is the What is the way you're funneling that campaign into a saleable product or a booked in client, and how are you converting that back through to make sure that, you know, it has been a successful use of your time and money? Those are the things that you need to set up and do from the get-go.
I have to cover this uncomfortable last question, and that is because it's really reared its head in the previous months with, you know, a few suicides, and that is bullies. How do you deal with bullies or trolls online?
Me personally, delete and block are your friends on social media. I think just like in when we're taught in schools, the moment you try and get into a slinging match with somebody about this, that or the other, you know, it spirals out of control and gets kind of crazy. It still hurts your feelings, and it's still nasty when somebody's rude or mean or whatever to you, or it might upset you or ruffle your feathers. But take a deep breath, hit delete or block or both, and just move on, I think is probably the best thing. There's no need to engage in heated discussion, no matter how passionate you are. So that's probably the best advice personally. I think don't engage. Don't engage with them, or if they've done it on their page, on your page, and you feel like you need to respond, I think it's kill people with kindness. Just thank you for your opinion. It actually, you know, it doesn't necessarily change the shape of what I do or who I am, but you know, you're entitled to it. And good day to you. Goodbye.
Don't let them define you though.
No, absolutely not. Absolutely not. And the thing is, I see it all the time on a lot of posts, with the exception of maybe news posts and things like that, where I think that they deliberately target their titles and what have you to attract that kind of discussion, because the more people comment on a post, the more reach it gets. You know, it's part of the strategy. But in general, if we're talking our industry, the thing I hate about bullies and troll type comments is that you'll have 50 amazing comments, let's say, and you have 3 bad ones, and they're the ones you focus on. So it's just kind of delete, block, ignore, and move on, and focus on the 50 that said amazing things to you. I think that's probably the best thing everyone could do, with a little bit more love and a little less hate, right?
Well, true, but also in reality, you can't expect the whole world to agree. So there is bound to be somebody that will dislike or disagree, and it depends on them as to their behaviour. That's I think, the telling thing is how they behave is relevant to them, not relevant to you.
Definitely. And probably the other thing is to check yourself. If you're commenting on anything on social media, check yourself. Check before you hit enter or hit post. Reread it. Read it out loud and read it with its proper grammar and punctuation, because, hello, I'm a grammar and punctuation Nazi over here. But read it out loud. And if you don't feel like it's saying the right thing in the right way, change the words. Change it. Sometimes saying things with like what at front in the front of the sentence, or how in the front of the sentence, in a speaking in a person-to-person situation, that's a very direct form of communication. But as soon as you transfer it over to writing, it can be a bit intrusive.
Yes.
So, you know, you might say something like how about, or what are your thoughts about this, or something, some kind of softer approach. But we definitely need to put more emphasis on the fact that we communicate very differently in the flesh than we communicate in an online space. But we also need to always ask ourselves, would I do or say this as I'm about to say it in the online space if that person was standing in front of me? And if the answer is no, just don't post it.